Something needs to change.
The hope is for change.
It's just up to each of us to be the change that we want to see in this game. Percentage of African Americans in leadership positions is nowhere near where it used to be.
There's no shortage of qualified African American men in this game. Here's what you ought to do, now just hold on.
They need to learn, they need to share, and you need to have some uncomfortable conversations because that's the only way things are going to change.
Hey, welcome to MLB Tonight, a conversation. I'm Harold Reynolds, your host, and tonight we'll examine the black ball player. What's happened with the numbers hovering around 8%? I remember when I broke into the big leagues in 1983, I played on a Seattle Mariner team that had 10 black players. When I made my first All-Star game in 1987, there were 17 black players in the game and 140 in the league. And we only had 26 teams in the league at that time. It's now moved to 30 teams in the league. And last year on Jackie Robinson Day, we had 3 teams that did not have a black player. 3 teams! 11 had one. 11 teams, including Jackie's old team, the Dodgers, had one. 11 teams. So what has happened? That's what we're going to get into tonight. I was discouraged as I looked at the numbers, as many have been. But as through the pandemic, people get together, we stopped, we listened, and we got real quiet. And it brought a group of black ball players together that said it's time to make a change. So I was encouraged because these guys right here came out with a video, Black Lives Matter, and they joined the movement, but the movement has gone not only from the streets, but to baseball as well. So tonight, we're gonna jump into the change in baseball and how we can get these numbers back to where they used to be when I was in the big leagues. And joining me now, Mr. CC Sabathia. CC, what's up, big fella?
What's up, Harold? How you doing?
I'm good. Tonight, we're gonna introduce you to the Players Alliance. That's who these gentlemen are. CC's the vice president of that. And joining me on the big board over here is the president, Mr. Curtis Granderson, down here in the bottom with the One Team, One Dream. How you doing, Curtis? Good to see you, man.
Thanks for having me.
Always good. To Curtis's left, right over here to my right, is Cameron Maben, current player, Detroit Tigers. Welcome back to Detroit, Cam.
Appreciate you having me on, H.
All right. And then up top above Curtis there is D. Gordon for the Seattle Mariners. D, how you doing, buddy?
Doing good. Thank y'all for having me, man.
Current All-Star player. And then over here, Mr. Edwin Jackson. Everybody knows who he is. Played for 14 teams on CC.
We were talking everybody about knows EJ.
Hey, yeah, so tonight, I'm excited to dive into the Players Alliance and how did the video come about and what are they doing now. So I'll start with asking that question first. CC, how'd this all get together?
Just like you said, just, you know, being quarantined, being at home, and then just the events that's occurred in the United States the past couple months, you know, got together, Cam and EJ and D really kind of came together and put this group together, started like a big text chain, and, you know, we just kind of took off from there, and it's been great because all of us do stuff individually, but now to have us all collectively be together, it's a really good feeling.
No doubt. You know, it really started to catch steam. I'm going to come back to you in a minute, Curtis, but I want to go to Cam because this really caught steam with the Black Lives video. So how did the video come about, Cam?
It came about, I called D. I think we were actually sharing a brainwave that day. I called D because I just saw a spot on the NFL Network with all of those guys coming together and acknowledging, you know, what is going on in our communities, the communities that we hold so near and dear to our hearts. And Dee just so happened to just see it. And he said, we need to do something, man. Like, we got to do something. You know, you know, a lot of days have went by, weeks have went by, and, you know, we haven't really used our voices, and we need to do something. And when he said that, I've got a great team. Curtis uses the same team for years, culture group. And we got together with EJ, who is the common denominator who brings everybody together. And, you know, once we call EJ, you can consider it done. You know, if EJ picks up the phone, it's as good as done.
And when they're talking about you like you're the mayor, you know everybody. Of course, 14 teams. So you do have everybody in your Rolodex.
I mean, that's what happened when you have a phone full of numbers, full of teammates, Harold. Been on almost half of the teams in the league and play with a lot of people from minor league to major league. So it was easy for me to get on a call or send a text and connect to a lot of teammates and a lot of friends that I have in the game. So we did that and put this group together, and it's becoming the entity that we have now.
Go ahead, C.
But to EJ's credit, though, like, it's not just guys that he played with. If he sees another black guy on the other team, he'll make sure, like, he alters his running to go say what's up and, like, make sure, you know, guys are good. And, you know, that, I mean, he's just one of those ambassadors of the game for, you know, all the young black players.
That's cool. D, I'm going to go to you because I want to talk to Curtis for a minute here about the structure of all this. Okay. But, D, I want to ask you, the early conversations with you and Cam, how did it come about to try to stay in touch during the pandemic?
It's crazy. We actually put a group chat together right when the pandemic started, if I want to be right. We put a group chat together as soon as the pandemic started, and we just kind of was just like, you know, checking on each other. And when we saw the Black Lives Matter video, it was a no-brainer with myself definitely being a second-generation big leaguer that our numbers are not good. So, we needed to stand up and use our voice to help get these young kids, you know, into the majors.
Hey, Curtis, usually the president gets to go first. You know, Curtis is the president of the Players Alliance here. When this all started coming together, obviously you have to have organization. How did this start going from a video and some social justice outreach to an organization?
Well, before getting started with that, thanks again for having us on there. And I got to say, I'm jealous, Harold, for you to say you played with a team with 10 black ball players on it. Throughout my entire life, from T-ball until I retired, I never had that many players. I'm sure the rest of the guys on this board can say the exact same thing. I was fortunate if I had two, maybe three. D might have had it, you know. But, you know, EJ, D, and Cam were talking and just getting a lot of guys together talking about things that we had been consistently talking about throughout the course of our careers. Just, man, every Jackie Robinson day, they keep talking about the numbers going down in the black community, not only in the major league level, the minor league level, the college level, the youth level. So these conversations have been had for years. And now with everybody finally getting a chance to slow down and stop, we said, all right, now we can collectively bring our voices together and really go out there and make change. For everybody out there, just so you're aware of, the guys on this call plus the 120 members of the Players Alliance have collectively over the past 5 years alone contributed over $40 million of our own money to our home communities, to the cities we play in, to areas that don't have Major League Baseball, to bring the game to them, to introduce it to them, to keep it fun. And that's where the Players Alliance has started, and we'll continue to keep moving forward.
No, one of the things that in my time getting to spend time talking with you guys is the left hand didn't know what the right hand was doing. But the accomplishments are important. Not only, as Curtis was talking about, the money they've contributed in black communities around the teams they've played on, there's 20 guys that have been nominated for the Roberto Clemente Award in this group as well. That's really impressive. But looking at all the things that they've accomplished as a group, you got Cy Young Award winners, MVPs, you've got it all. I'm really impressed that you guys have been able to recognize it and bring it together. So I guess, CC, the thought I have is, what were the first reactions of people when the video came out that were not collectively in the group, so to speak?
I think everybody had a good reaction to it. I think, you know, if everybody's been listening to what we've been saying, they know that, you know, it's a problem in Major League Baseball, that there's not enough black players. So for us to be able to actually come together, make this video, and then put, you know, the Players Alliance together, you know, I think we're off to a good start in really just 3 weeks, you know, less than a month. And I think, you know, we're off to doing some really, really great things, accomplishing some great things all together.
Hey, Edwin, I know you're going to get some calls to pitch because, you know, this is a little short season. I know you're not signed right now and you're kind of saying I'm retiring. I don't know if that's going to stick that way. I want to ask D and Cam, who are in camp right now, what were the reactions of your teammates, your white teammates in particular, after seeing the video and then you guys showing up with all the things going on in our country? I'll start with you, D.
Honestly, man, a lot of my teammates reached out to me as soon as they saw the video and things like that. You know, I'm cool with everybody in the locker room. Cam played with me. EJ played with me. You know, I'm cool with everybody in my locker room. So everybody was pretty cool about it. You know, they want to know how they can help. They want to know how they can be educated. And pretty much that's what I all told them. Like, make sure, you know, if anything, when you hear somebody say something that's not right, just speak up. You ain't got to really stand up with us. Just speak up when you hear something that's not right.
Cam, I want to ask you that because there's been some the big theme, I guess, universally is let's talk. Let's have a conversation. I'm listening, and people are listening now. So I'm curious, what was one of the conversations you might have with a teammate that called you up or either met you on the field or whatever it might be?
You know, it's still a sensitive conversation. It's a conversation that we do need to have amongst each other. That's the only way we get better and we get closer to the change that we want to create. I don't want to pressure anybody, you know, in any locker room or make them do anything that makes them uncomfortable, you know. But, you know, I'm very fortunate that I've had a handful of teammates come up and acknowledge what we have done thus far and the support that they, you know, that they also have for this Players Alliance. You know, Matt Boyd in particular came up to me and was extremely vocal about, you know, whatever he could do to help, you know, spread our message, show his alliance and his support. You know, he would be all willing to do that. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for allies right now. Because that's the only way we can create change. And if that's, you know, we have to do it together to be the change that we want to be. Just like the shirt Curtis is rocking right now, it says what our message is about. So I'm very fortunate to have teammates like Matt Boyd, Spence Turnbull, who have, you know, came up to me open-minded about the conversation that I know isn't an easy conversation. You know, I love those guys for that. And that's what we're looking to do, you know, have conversations just to make this a better game for not only Black players, but for everybody.
And just so you know, I mean, these conversations we're having aren't just with the teammates in the locker room, you know, whether it's neighbors, community, friends, mm-hmm. family, everybody is supporting and wanting to be a part of this. They want to see change both in the game and off the field. People understand that there's a lot of stuff that's been going on that they aren't happy with. And it's not just the Black thing right here. And a lot of people, like Cam mentioned, are allies to what we, the Players Alliance, are going to be doing and want to be doing. There's so much change, again, that we've already been trying to introduce and implement throughout the course of this game and on the field and off the field. But again, the support has been amazing from the video to the little things that we've done so far. And like CC said, it's been less than a month. And look at all the things that we've slowly been able to do. And yeah, people need to realize if we could have fixed this thing, it would have been done by now. Yeah. So it's going to take some time, but we're going to definitely be doing it slowly but surely.
I love it. I love it. Well, we're going to continue this conversation, all right, because I want to ask you guys, owners, the PA, what reactions you might have had. Have you had conversations? And what kind of change are you going to make? It's cool to have a great video, but when they come back, they're going to talk about how they're going to implement change in their communities. Back in a moment.
Now we're at a spot where, like, yeah, we know what's happening, but we can say something. And that's what this space is, Players Alliance. Like, we've all been there. I mean, looking out there and at the outfield, I'm playing center field. I got two white guys playing left and right, and they're calling us a reverse Oreo. And
I'm almost in shock every time I hear or see something, because I can't believe in 2020, you know, people still act the way they act.
You got to try to play the game within the game, too, which is being personal, being coachable, being a good teammate.
In all my years, if I can give you any kind of wisdom, it's not mechanics. Your mentality is your mechanics.
Don't let nobody tell you that you're not good enough to play, or you can't do this, you can't wear that. Like, be yourself, man. But be respectful at the same time. There's a fine line, but never lose sight of who you are as a person.
This is going to continue to keep growing because, again, there's not that many of us.
That's the mentorship program that the Players Alliance has put together for those youngsters that are coming up behind them. And we'll dive into some more other things you're doing, but the mentorship program, that was powerful. Who came up with that idea? Where'd that come from?
That actually came from D, if I can remember correctly, just because he's so connected to all the young players, you know, trying to get guys to perfect game tournaments, different things like that. And he was just like, hey, what if we just started talking to some of these new draft picks and some of these guys that are coming up through the ranks? And, you know, it turned out to be a great night. That was one of the funnest nights I've had so far, is being a part of the
Players.
What
were some of the things discussed? What was discussed on that? I'll go with Curtis. You give me something on that. What was discussed?
It was great. We brought in the recently drafted black players. And just for everyone to know, I think there was only 13 black players in this year's draft. So, again, think about all the stuff we're talking about, things we're trying to address. And because of the pandemic, guys don't always get a chance to be around each other to meet and interact for the first time. So using Zoom and using technology that we have now, we were still able to make that connection, bringing former players like CC, myself, Torrey Hunter, with some of the current players that you see here, D. Gordon, Edwin Jackson, Cameron Maben, and then some of the recently drafted guys, just to let them know the ropes. I mean, CC had probably one of the best lines. Learn some life skills. Learn how to do your laundry. Learn how to wash your clothes, how to get up. You forget how that stuff is so important, but some of these drafts are only 18 years old. So remember where you were when you were 18 years old, when you were on your way to college, or you were leaving home for the first time, and now you're all of a sudden, you have a professional job where you have to go out there and perform. Having some of those basic life skills can take you a very long way. And Isaiah Green is from California. So we connected him with CC Sabathia from California and Dom Smith from California. So a great way to bridge the gap to get these guys introduced to the game.
Hey, Edwin, first time you left home, what stood out? I saw you nodding your head in that conversation. Were you not doing your own laundry or what?
Man, Harold, I'm a country boy from Georgia, man. My mom made me do my laundry. Now, I did have days when she would iron for me, but that's one of the things, man. It's a shock for sure. I mean, you go from high school to on your own, and it's not college, it's not anything. You go to the major league or the minor league level, which is still professional baseball. You're doing everything on your own. You're doing your own laundry. You have to iron your own clothes. A lot of those things, when you're from the South, your parents or your mom, more so your mom, do a lot of those things for you. So once you get grown, you have to do it on your own. But I was ready. I was ready for it, Harold.
You know, you brought up something there. You're out of high school. And if you look at the majority of Major League black players, they've come out of high school. Not many guys are getting that opportunity to go to college, be drafted, and signed out of college. Curtis, you're like an exception. I think you went to a year of junior college or something like that, right? Mm-hmm. But for the most part, you can go all the way back to Derek Jeter and move forward. That opportunity to go to college is not really that same option. So, Cam, I know you came out of high school and signed. When you're leaving home and you're sitting there with that dream in front of you, what was your thoughts then, and what were you equipped for?
You know, my situation was a little bit different. I was very fortunate that at age 15, I was selected to go play with a group called the Midland Redskins out of Cincinnati, Ohio. So at age 15, I think it was after my freshman year, I had to go and live with a host family. And that host family did not wash your clothes. They did not do your laundry. So at a very early age, my mom was extremely happy when I came back that summer. And I was doing my own laundry, and I was making, I call it surviving, making my own meals if I needed to eat. And I also was a bat boy for 3 years for the Asheville Tourists. And I've always been a pretty big kid, so I had the opportunity to take BP, take infield and outfield. I had a chance to pick guys like Mickey Brantley's mind. And, you know, thank God for Mickey Brantley. You know, he told me when I was 15, you know, hey, kid, you might have a bright future in this game. But, you know, a little advice when you get drafted and when you get drafted as a young black man, you know, you have three strikes. When they call your name, they take one away sometimes just because you're black, you know. And I thought that was great advice. Just, you know, I think basically what he was saying was make sure you be on your P's and Q's, because that's just the way the game is. And that's the way it's always been. So
What you just said there, though, about the three strikes, someone sitting at home is going, really? That happens? D, yeah. I see you shaking your head. Curtis, tell me why that happens, D. I know myself you're telling the truth, but explain that to America.
First of all, America, I'm scared to say this out loud, just to let y'all know. But it's literally like, you know, we come with a pizzazz with us. We come with a flair, you know. But we, most of us come up from playing any sport or doing anything. We was better than everybody, and we have a little bit of a swag about ourselves about it. The strike thing means, like, you just got to be perfect. You got to do the right things every day. You know, the numbers speak for themselves, being at 8%. So you got to be perfect to be part of that 8%.
No, I when I was coming up, they were like, you got to be twice as good. Don't make mistakes. And I played in the 80s and 90s, and you're saying that still stands today, CC?
Yeah, I mean, I came up and I had Ellis Burks right away. He was my vet. Like, he took care of me, but that was the first thing he made sure that he conveyed. It was like, make sure you play the game within the game. Make sure that you're coachable. Make sure that you're a good teammate. You know, you can wear your hat to the side, but you know what I mean? Like, you make sure you're doing all these things first, and make sure that you going out winning games to be able to keep being yourself.
Yeah, and I just want to say, and when I said that, like CeCe said, like, that was just one conversation that I had at 15. Like, as you get into it, Orlando Hudson, you know, Adam Jones, you know, and it was just like CeCe said, like, hey, like, we got to be a little bit more straight and narrow. And that's just what I was taught, you know. So, again, like D said, I don't want America thinking that's what I was made up. But this is a long history and a long line of advice trickling down from, you know, former black players to current black players. And it's always been a little bit of like, hey, like, you know, sometimes you may see somebody else doing something, but you might just want to hang back and not get involved, because it, you know, we might not have the same consequences or circumstances. So, you know, like I said, this was just advice that was passed down, you know, to me. I was very lucky to have Curtis Granderson, somebody like him. I watched, had Curtis move, and had Curtis did things. And, you know, I've tried to carry a lot of that into my career, because, you know, I've seen how far that can get you.
Like I said, I'm a second generation big leaguer. My dad been in the majors for 21 years. So, you know, he's been on me about the two strike thing. Like, you know, it's happened, you know, being around J-Roll, being around Mike Bourne, being around EJ, seeing Cam be straight and narrow in Lakeland in 2007. Like, I've been around it. I've seen these guys do it. So, you know, it's kind of mandatory that you fall in line.
I've seen players even as well when I was coming up where there were guys that we had rules on the team. You know, you had to wear your hair a certain way. It couldn't be too long. I understand rules are for everybody, but I saw black players be told to cut their hair. And then after they cut their hair, they were released. This happened multiple times. I didn't see the white players get asked to cut their hair. And if they did, they definitely weren't released afterwards. These are true things that happened back when I was coming up in the minor league. So these are some of the things that we're talking about that we've experienced as players, as teammates. And if you notice, just looking at even the five guys on this call, we have a batting champ, we have a pitcher with a no-hitter, we have a World Series champ, we have a future Hall of Famer in CC. If you are a black player in this game, you're probably a standout player, like D said. You're not that guy that's the 25th guy on the roster. You're not the guy that's the last guy name being called. The black players that are part of the Players Alliance have been some of the top players. Look at the accolades, MVPs, All-Stars, Gold Gloves, Silver Sluggers. So when you're talking about having those two or three strikes, we're playing as hard as we can. We're trying to produce as hard as we can. Just like everything else we're talking about, we want everybody to be equal across the board. If we have to keep doing all those things and our numbers are still this low, these are some of the problems that, again, that we're trying to address.
No, I was thinking about this, too. When was the last time you saw a black catcher? You start looking at the DH. Now we're rotating that DH. That used to be where Gary Ward or Dave Winfield or Eddie Murray or Reggie or somebody went at the end of their career. That's not there for you guys now as a complete job. You know, then you talk about pitching. There's not a lot of black pitchers coming out of the bullpen. You know, so those are the things that are happening and why these things are being addressed in this conversation is important. So I want to keep it on the fact that this is the mentorship stuff you're talking about. You were passing these lessons and these conversations on?
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, it's up to us now. You know, like how we talked about the Ellis Burks and Adam Joneses, and we're those guys now sitting in this position to pass it on to the younger players, and it's our duty. And really, it's our duty to start this Players Alliance to make sure that, you know, 10 years from now, they're not doing the same thing and explaining the same things to the guys coming in, you know, hopefully we can make some change and, you know, get some utility players, have a catcher, you know what I'm saying? Different things in the game that we're just kind of cut out of.
Guys, I know I told you we're going to get to the list, and we're going to do that. But you've been so good at what you're talking about. It's been deep. It's smoking. I had to stay there. So when we come back, we're going to go through the list. I'm going to go to the list of some of the things you're talking about doing and wanting to do as we get a chance to look at some of this stuff. The mentorship program we talked about, Gear for Good, the Alliance Access Program for scholarships and things like that. Curtis, can you dive in, go ahead and explain a little bit about Gear for Good, the Alliance, and I'll let CC talk about Kansas City and the Negro Leagues, which are passionate for him.
You got, and you touched on the DH, just for food for thought. Frank Thomas, back-to-back MVPs as a DH. Only guy to do that, black player that did that. So again, talking about the best guys out there doing it, Frank Thomas is the only DH to do that in history. So keep that in mind. But along the lines of all the different programs that we got going on, our mentorship program is something immediately that we can have impact on the new guys coming into the game. Mason Wynn, a recently drafted player from the Cincinnati Reds, reached out to me after the fact and saying, not growing up with African-American men in my life, having that mentorship call meant the world to me. Being able to look up to you guys as fans and getting a chance to talk to you and be educated by you before I get ready to start my professional career means the world to me. And this is just one of the players that was on that call. CC said it himself. It was great for him to do it. It was one of his favorite moments on there. Our Gear for Good. We always talk about barriers of entry into this game, how expensive the game is. If you ever want to know how expensive it is, go buy a baseball bat, an aluminum baseball bat. If you think it gets cheaper with a wood bat, go buy a wood bat. You will see how expensive it is just to get equipment to play the game. Now you add in fees and travel and all these different things. So one of the things consistently every year, there's always been equipment that guys have extra that they try to donate and get out to some of the minor league players in some of the Latin American countries. And rightfully so, these players are needing it. But also in the black communities, they need it. So we're going to step forward, use our existing contracts with the New Balances, the Nikes, the Adidases, the Jordan brands, and so on, to say, hey, we have this excess equipment. These young kids that want to play the game, that don't have access to equipment, we want to make sure that they have it available for them. And of course, the Alliance, we want to make sure that we're providing internships, that we're trying to help from the top down, all the way from the general managers, the owners, the coaches, the scouts, the trainers. Look at the New York Yankees, for example. The New York Yankees have two black coaches, one black scout. And before this draft, they only had 9 black players. The New York Yankees is the most recognizable team in sports. So for that organization to be the most recognizable, to be in one of the most diverse cities in the world, and that's the breakup of just some of their key areas, these are some of the things that we want to try to address.
No, and another thing you said was being able to get these kids opportunities to play. And CeCe, you talk passionately about your kids playing AAU basketball, and you're seeing all these things taken care of. And you talked about need to have an opportunity like in Kansas City, the Negro League Museum. Explain Kansas City.
Yeah, so Kansas City is exciting for me. Obviously, the Negro League Museum is there. And I thought, you know, the MLB does that great Dream Series where they play, they have the top 20 or 40 kids go out to Arizona and they play in a game. I thought, why not bring that to Kansas City, have a former, and I mean, a lot of current and former players go there, hang out for the series and be able to walk through the museum and start giving these kids a history
lesson.
Negro
League Museum, 18th and Vine in Kansas City.
Yeah, and I mean, it's beautiful. And like Kurt said earlier, you know, everybody's been to Cooperstown and that place is beautiful. But if you haven't been to Kansas City and seen that Negro League Museum, it means a lot. It's near and dear to my heart and it's a beautiful place to play. It's a beautiful place to go see. And I think it'll be a cool place for these kids to go play.
Hey, Curtis, it's powerful stuff. I want to end it with this, though. If I'm an owner or if you're part of the PA, they're probably wondering what's going on. Have you had conversations with the owners at all and with the PA or a combination at all?
We have, and we've been fortunate. So everybody knows this is a collective effort to go out there and want to see change. General managers have reached out to us. Owners have reached out to us. We've had a call today with 30 major league owners all trying to find ways to better improve the game. People see this as a potential issue, and we got to try to find ways to do it. So that includes Major League Baseball, the Players Association, and the 30 owners are all doing things that have never been done because we collectively, as the Players Alliance, have stepped forward and started asking for that change. For example, the Toronto Blue Jays just recently had a call with some of their black players, Anthony Alford and Jonathan Davis, and Bo Bichette. And I'm sure you're thinking, Bo Bichette's not black, but Bo Bichette went to an all-black high school. So bringing these guys in to talk about the issues they faced growing up, to talk about their experiences and to see ways they can have change. D. Gordon was invited to bring in four or five of his Black teammates to talk about what's it like to be a Black player. D, touch on that, because you mentioned how just the craziness of just being able to have that conversation.
Right. It was eye-opening, man. I've never... These guys know I talk trash all day. But for somebody to, like, ask me, I was... Honestly, first of all, I was petrified. But I knew with having nine other younger Black players on my team, I needed to speak up. And so I had to do what I had to do. And, you know, I just spoke up. You guys are more than welcome to get the video so you can see it.
Well, hey, proud of what you guys are doing. This is going to happen. It's about time. You got all the former players and everybody else behind you as well. But the beauty of this is a collective effort. That it's not just you guys sitting there alone being Black players. You got a lot of folks coming along. So I want to thank D. Gordon. Go get him, man. Have a great year. Edwin, you got one thing you were going to say?
I think something important to include, Harold, before we get off this, that we do have allies of the Alliance. This is not only just for Black players. We want to include any of our teammates, any of our players that want to be involved in what we have going on. I think that is super important. So we're not excluding anyone. We want to include in everyone. We want this to really be one team, one dream. I know we have a lot of Black players, and it was the importance of that. But we definitely need the support of our teammates of other races and other ethnicities.
I love it. Nice job, Edwin. Cam, go get him, man. Welcome back to Detroit, like I said earlier. Curtis, thank you for the time. Appreciate it. We'll be in touch with all you guys. I know you got big things coming, announcements coming forward. CC Sabathia, come back, man, before 5 years when you're in Cooperstown, all right? All right, hey, appreciate it. We'll see you guys later. Coming up next, the guys talked about it. How are we going to get moving in the lower ranks? Well, it's already happened with MLB, and we'll meet with Tony Regans, Executive Vice President. We'll get into that next. Welcome back to MLB Tonight, a conversation. Joining me now, Tony Regans, Executive Vice President of Baseball and Softball Development for Major League Baseball. You're the highest ranking Black executive in Major League Baseball. Am I correct?
Yeah, that's right. Been there for 5 years now, and, you know, we're doing a lot of fun things and a lot of exciting things. And, you know, we're just excited about getting the opportunity to even do more. So looking forward to it.
Well, you got to be excited about what you just heard from those players. I know it excites me, and as I think about the possibilities, what was your reaction?
Encouraged. You know, one of the things that stuck out to me is they talked about from the top down, working from the top down, and what we're doing, we're working from the bottom up. So we'll meet them in the middle and hopefully make some change.
You talked about bottom up and the grassroots programs. What are some of those programs and how essential are they?
You know, they're extremely important, right, because that's how you expand the base. You know, you start with the pitch, hit, and run program, free program. Any kid can participate, and I'm excited about introducing that to the Players Alliance as a way to reach more kids. The Junior Home Run Derby is another free program that, you know, doesn't cost any money to be a part of. The Academies, another free program that is more about building the entire athlete, not just the baseball side of it, but the whole person. The RBI program, which is community baseball, has been around for many, many years, but we want to do more in that area. So there's a lot of grassroots initiatives that we have in place. The Fun at Bat program, which is an elementary school program, grades K through 5, that introduce baseball throughout the school day. We're just excited about being able to introduce baseball and softball around the world.
I appreciate it, man. That's great stuff. We got to introduce them. Then we got to raise them up.
That's right.
So coming back, we're going to talk to some scouts. How am I going to be found? What are we going to do? Is there an Ozzie Smith out there, Eddie Murray? You know, these guys all came out of the inner city. Why are we not in the inner cities? Or are we? We're going to check it out here. We come back.
And the batter is on. Smith, court 20 to right down.
Hits it high and deep to center field. Gone. Home run. Oh. to left. It's gone.
Davis with another shot.
What did Eddie Murray, Ozzie Smith, Daryl Strawberry, Eric Davis, you saw Sheffield and Dwight Gooden, all out of the inner city. Are we in the inner city scouting? Are those players still having an opportunity? Well, I'm joined by two men that can get to the bottom of that real quick for me. Right here to my left with the Colorado Rockies, Danny Montgomery. Danny, thank you for joining me. Appreciate that.
Thank you, Harold.
And from the Pittsburgh Pirates, McCollum the Preacher, Steve Williams. Thanks, Steve. Appreciate you joining us. Guys, thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, this is an important conversation. You know, we've been talking a lot about black kids and opportunities in baseball. So the question is, if you're in the inner city, are you going to have an opportunity to have scouts come see you? Danny, I'll start with you first.
Well, given the fact that I've been, you know, my emphasis has been mostly on the amateur side for those the past 30 plus years. I think that we are, you know, in the inner cities. I think that there's a difference of, you know, back in the day when, you know, ED and all those guys came out and Daryl and Sheffield and the crew. I think it's, there's some clubs that do a very good job with getting in there and identifying guys that deserve this opportunity at this league. But athletic wise, yeah, if you are a scout and you have any kind of idea of instincts or, you know, the type of player that we're looking for, you have to dig. That's part of what, you know, some clubs do. I think some clubs do a very good job on it, and others may not go in it as much as it was back in the day.
Hey, I know something you both are passionate about as well is the importance of education and how that opens so many other doors that I think is a secret that's being missed. So, Steve, I'm going to throw that to you, Preacher, and just go ahead and take that for a minute on the education part.
Yeah, I can talk about myself. I mean, went to college at Clemson University, got into scouting right after. I think that that definitely gave me the avenue and a pathway to get in because I was a former player at the college level, came out with my degree. I think we have to really push education even more. I don't think we do it enough. I think we need to allow these kids to get the opportunity to get that critical thinking in. And allow them to grow up. I think sometimes with the challenges of coming into pro ball for some players is that it's just, you know, they're expected to perform very quickly. And I think that we've done a really good job with signing players. We've done a really good job of getting in the system and trying to develop them. But I think some of these young men, they need to go to college for that maturity level. They need to go to college for that critical thinking. It's extremely important.
That's great advice. Great advice. Gentlemen, thank you. There's so much more we can dive in and talk about, but hitting home, I think people are going to be a little surprised to hear scouts saying you got to get that education to get an opportunity, too, to open those doors even more. Danny, Preacher, appreciate y'all. Thank you for the time.
Thank you.
We'll catch up soon.
You're the best. Thanks,
Harold. That was very important stuff. Well, talking about college, we got a couple college coaches coming up. One, he just went in the Hall of Fame. I'm talking about Roger Cador. The other one, he's got 17 black players on his roster. What? Yeah, Eastern Kentucky's Edwin Thompson. We'll be back in a moment.
I was a product of HBCU.
With him going to Florida A&M, he was the first big name that people recognized. But you have the rights of Lou Brock.
Here's a base hit.
Grissom, Vince Coleman. They're also products of Florida A&M University.
Marquise Grissom, what a catch! That was outstanding.
Don't even throw it. It's useless.
And number 100.
I'm so proud of that, being from HBC school. Getting an opportunity to go out and showcase my skills.
Wiggs hits one hard. This is way back.
I have plenty of family members that went to HBCU, so I really want to go to HBCU.
You really did get recruited as a baseball player by a lot of the major colleges, major universities.
We continue to go out and share this opportunity with them and let them know this is the best game in the world.
For a lot of these kids, it's an opportunity, again, to extend your career at the next level.
Now, I bet you didn't know that many ball players came out of the HBCUs. I mean, it's incredible. Hall of Famers, faces of franchises. But the question is, when I turn on the TV now and I watch the Andre Dawson Classic, where are the black players? So I brought a Hall of Fame coach, Roger Cador, 33 years at Southern University. Roger, thanks for joining me. I appreciate it. First of all, congratulations on the induction to the Hall of Fame.
Harold, thanks. It was a beautiful honor, and I'm just happy to be a part of it.
So my question, my first one is, when you took over the job at Southern 33 years ago, what were the rosters like in the HBCU leagues?
100% African-Americans.
And so what happened?
Time changed. There are a lot of things happened. Well, the limited scholarship, the cost, and what happened is that if you wanted to win, what we found out coming out of high school, the white coaches were putting all of the best athletes in the outfield. So if you wanted to win, you had to diverse to get catchers, pitchers, middle infielders, third baseman. So that was a tremendous amount of shortage of those position players. So you had to go somewhere else to be competitive.
Now, you continued to compete. When you started 33 years ago, Dusty Baker helped you start your program with equipment and things like that. You had to do a lot of fundraising. Along the way, though, you were able to land the top player in the country, Golden Spikes Award winner Ricky Weeks, who went on to be a Major League Baseball player. How were you able to land Ricky Weeks?
Well, first you had to find out that he existed. And one of my former coaches, Jerry Flowers, with the Cincinnati Reds, who is now a national cross-checker, he was snowbirding down in Florida, and he saw this kid. And he called me and said, you got to get him. He's the real deal. So got his number, talked to Ricky, and then I talked to his mother, Valeria. And it was literally love at first sight. Valeria made the decision that I was the man that she wanted her son to play for.
So was there a moment or a time or a conversation that you as a black coach probably had with Ricky Weeks that somebody else may not have had the courage to have?
Yeah, when we used the Bo Jackson scenario, who had a speech impediment, Ricky did also. And I told Ricky, I said, you're going to be a good player. A lot of interviews are going to happen. I need to get someone to work with you so you could be prepared to be able to handle these interviews. And what I did, Harold, Ricky used to come to my office every day. Every day. So I gave Ricky at night, I said, listen, I have this lady who's going to come work with you. Here's the key to the office. Y'all can work in secrecy. Nobody will know it. And this lady did a fantastic job. Named Melanie Power Ray worked with Ricky, and they got it together.
I think sometimes what I see happening, or for sure happened years ago, was young black men searching for that father figure. I would think that would get, it probably gave you a little bit of an advantage, I would think. Am I right or am I wrong with that?
A tremendous advantage. The mother said to me, take my son and make a man out of him. And I tell you, so many mothers in the inner city, the Chicago's, the Detroit, the Atlanta, the Houston, I tell you, all of those cities, those single mothers just trusted me that I would do the kind of job that they didn't have a husband or father to work with their sons with.
Roger, I thank you for the time. Hall of Famer, congratulations. Appreciate you. Well, here's one of the hottest upcoming coaches in college baseball. You look at Eastern Kentucky University baseball, back-to-back 30 wins. I want you to look down there at the bottom, though. Recruited and coached 20 All-Americans, 42 players have played pro baseball. Now, he's knocked off some big schools. He's knocked off Mississippi State. He's had a chance to knock off LSU this year. I'm talking about Edwin Thompson. Edwin, thanks for joining me, man. I appreciate it.
Hey, thanks, Harold. Thanks for having me on. And, you know, I'm excited to talk some baseball tonight.
Well, you know, we're talking a lot tonight about the plight of the black baseball player. And when it comes to college with 11.7 scholarships, there's not many black baseball players in college, although that's what it seems like. You have 17 of 35-man roster on your team. How'd that come about?
Well, you know, I have a great recruiting coordinator in Julius McDougal. My assistant coach, Sean Cole, and myself, we work really hard to find the best players we can. Eastern Kentucky is a great institution to first-generation kids, and we try to go out and hit as many events as we can We've utilized the Major League Baseball events that are out there, like the Breakthrough Series, the Hank Aaron Invitational, RBI World Series, to identify great talent, and obviously utilizing our contacts with scouts and travel coaches around the country, that we've been able to put together a pretty good roster of some great players from different backgrounds.
Yeah, but you figured it out. You got 17 black kids playing on your team. So how come other universities can't get two or three?
It's a choice. Honestly, I think it's a choice that coaches have to make. And if they want to have a roster that looks like their university, which is diverse, most universities have a great representation of people who look different. They have to make a choice to do that. And we've made a point to do that. We've had success doing that on the field and off the field. So at the end of the day, I think that's what it comes down to.
So there's a lot of black kids playing. There's a lot of former black ball players. Why are there not more black coaches in college?
Well, you know, it comes down to athletic directors, presidents. They have to be able to hire people that look different than them. I think there's a small representation of black athletic directors, but at the same time, they have to hire the qualified people. I think as a black coach, I'm never looking to get just a job just because I'm black. I'm looking because I'm a good baseball coach. And I think that's anybody, all they want is to have that opportunity. And then it starts with coaching, hiring your assistant coaches, who are you going to hire? And I think in our baseball at the Division I level, we're lacking behind that area where people kind of don't, they make a choice, just like recruiting, not recruiting black players and not recruiting great coaches that may come from a different circle than they're used to.
Don't forget this name, Edwin Thompson. Thank you, man. Appreciate you.
Thanks for having me on. Thanks for all you guys do at the MLB Network.
Appreciate that. 17 black players on his roster. Coming up next, Bobby Scales joins me. Welcome back to MLB Tonight, a conversation. All right, joining me now, Bobby Scales, the minor league field coordinator for the Pittsburgh Pirates. Before that, Bobby, you were the farm director for the Angels. So people are probably wondering, why are you talking to Bobby Scales, the former major leaguer with the Cubs, about sabermetrics? How did you come upon sabermetrics?
Well, it was really, Harold, it was at the end of my career. I got into management with the Los Angeles Angels, and really and truly, I had a lot to learn. Obviously, anytime you transition from playing to any type of administrative position or scouting, whatever, you have a boatload of stuff to learn. And I was fortunate enough to get that opportunity with them and quickly realized, sitting in meetings, understanding how today's player was evaluated, that I had a lot to learn. So I had a seat at the table in terms of making certain decisions within the minor league system, evaluating players, but really and truly, until you understand the language that is spoken and how a player is evaluated, that you may have a seat at the table, but you don't have a voice. And the only way to have a voice is to understand and be adept at using the language of today's baseball.
Now, what about front offices? Because you know, and I know, it's one thing to be a player, but if you want to exact change, you're sitting in that position to make a change, whether it's a general manager, a farm director, an executive position. So if you don't know these numbers and speak that language, you could have been a 20-year veteran who understands the game inside and out, and it seems like you get cut off. So in pertaining to that athlete, how were you able to adjust, and what is your advice if someone says, I want to be in the front office? How do I get there?
Well, it's exactly that. It's understanding what the landscape looks like in today's baseball, and not just today's baseball, in baseball moving forward. The reality of the situation is this. There's not an industry in the world where you don't use big data and advanced analytics to make better decisions, and that's really all this is. This is not some type of sea change that is just radical and out there. This has been something that's evolved over the last probably 20 years in professional baseball. But if you look at the greater scope of industry worldwide, there are every industry in the world. I don't care what you're doing, whether you're in sales, whether you're in marketing, whether you're in, you know, even farming, agriculture is using big data and analytics to enhance their industry and make better decisions while doing so. My biggest thing is I just don't want these guys to think that there's not guys like that look like me and you can't do these things, and guys that don't go to Harvard and Yale. There's a kid playing for Coach Cater right now that could do all these jobs. We just got to give him the opportunity to do it.
Yeah.
You know. So. Yeah. You know, it's not, this stuff's not rocket science. It's genuinely not. We just have to help these guys understand what they need to know as they're either winding down their career or trying to get in.
Man, that's some powerful stuff, things that people hadn't thought about. Better start early, but it doesn't limit you to have to be a Harvard grad or an Ivy League. You know, here's a guy from Michigan that learned that, former ball player, so we can dive into those numbers. Bobby Scales, great. Appreciate you, my man. Thank you for joining.
Always a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Some tremendous insight from Bobby Scales, but I'll tell you about a manager who had to deal directly with sabermetrics at the heat and the top of it. Yeah, I'm talking about Bo Porter when he went to the Astros. We'll talk about his time at the Astros and are there barriers because of sabermetrics.
A certain leading sabermetric crusader called the Astros the team of the future, which they are.
There's a reason why the Houston Astros have hired the director of decision sciences. This is the future.
The world of using all the data available to make your decisions was something that permeated the entire organization.
They are doing this holistically, a complete teardown, building it up, and I've never seen all the ideas and innovation filtered from the very top all the way down to the field. I've never seen it like this. That's why I think they're going to be a powerhouse in the next 5 years.
Well, you heard the voice of Brian Kenny talking about they're going to tear it down and build it back up, but somebody has to manage that team and get through the teardown, and that fell on my next guest, Mr. Bo Porter. Bo, I want to jump right into the back to you got that job at age 40 with the Astros. How'd that come about in the first place?
Well, one, I think it came about because, you know, I was a young coach and on the circuit of all the conversations that was taking place about managerial openings. And I think, again, it's all about timing. And when you look at the Houston Astros, actually, I was living in Houston at the time. So I had a lot of people within the Houston community that had experience with me. And there were a lot of people that actually knew Jim Crane that actually basically highly recommended me to Jim Crane. And I think throughout the interview process, they were looking for someone young that actually had the ability to actually deal with what they knew was going to be a very tough situation.
So Bo, I want to ask you this. I feel like the black manager's kind of been put in a box. That's just my personal feeling. I've watched you not get another job, Willie Randolph not get another job, other guys not get it. And it's been this big craze of the numbers coming in, and you've been branded like you couldn't handle it. Why do you feel like you haven't got another job, Willie Randolph, other guys like that?
Well, again, I think when you start to look at the manager position in baseball, Harold, I think it comes down to one very unique characteristic in which is taking place now. It has to be a relationship with the front office. And if you start to look at the front offices of baseball, and again, my hat is off to Theo Epstein, who actually, when you start to talk about transformational leadership, I commend him for coming out and making the statement that he made. He said, I need to look inward. We all need to look inward and ask ourselves the question, why do we make the decisions that we make when it comes to hiring key positions? And he came out and said, I'm guilty of hiring people that basically look like me and basically fall into the same category that I fall into. So in Houston, I felt like I fell into a situation where obviously it was a complete teardown. One, I was young, I was energetic, I was sabermetrically inclined, I understood the analytical side of it, I was in it for the long haul. It came down to relationships. In a relationship, the person that is in the superior position, if they want the relationship to fail, by God, it's going to fail.
Wow, that's powerful stuff, Bo. Bo, thank you for the time. Appreciate that. And we'll get back at you soon another time, okay? And we're going to keep this conversation going as I bring a guy who has the experience from all sides as an all-star player, a manager, a coach. He's done it all. He's even got a plaque in Yankee Stadium named after him. Yeah, I'm talking about Willie Randolph, coming up next.
What is the home run, Willie Randolph?
He got everything he had on that one. 160 pounds worth of dynamite.
Randolph has awakened with a bat.
Pitch is lined to right center field. That'll be in for a hit. Oh, my.
What a job by Randolph. Bouncing ball. Nettles goes to Randolph. One over to first. In time.
Here we go. It's like kicking candy from a baby.
One of my heroes, when I went to Yankee Stadium, I was hoping, can I hit a ball like Willie opposite field? Yes, Willie Randolph joins us. Willie, thank you, man. Appreciate you joining me.
Good to be with you, H, always, brother. Good to see you.
Hey, you've done everything in this game, and so I want to kind of go where I started the show off. I started off talking about 1987 All-Star Game. In that game, you were the starter for the American League. I was your replacement, and there were 17 black players in that game. And now the numbers have dwindled so much, we haven't got there. Do you think we'll ever get back to those numbers again?
Well, I sure hope so, Harold. I mean, you know, we're just seeing like we're losing a whole generation of African American players out there. And, you know, we have to do better. We have to do more. Major League Baseball, you know, on the grassroots, we got to get out there. And the Parks Department has to do a better job. But when I go back to the inner city, I don't see a lot of baseball fields. And if they are there, they're not manicured. You know, baseball, you have to have a manicured field where you got to take care of the facility so you can go out there and put your nose down on the ground ball and feel good about it. So, you know, we need to, you know, really give them the facilities and the places where they can get out and really play and hone their skills. But I hope so, Harold, because, again, there's so many great athletes out there. The kids want to play. But the way the game is changing, evolving right now, it's been this way for a while. You know, you have all these showcases and you got all these travel teams, and it makes it very difficult for sometimes single family homes and kids to really enjoy the game because they just can't afford it.
No, you're absolutely right. You know, we had some scouts on earlier and they were talking about very similar things. Real quick, that 87 All-Star game, Willie came up to me and he said, "Hey, kid, I got a little bad leg. I'm going to take one at bat because, you know, I got voted in. And you go ahead and take the rest of the game."
Well, I tell you what, Harold, I appreciate you for pushing me all those years. I was getting towards the end, so guys, young bucks like you kept me on my toes, so I appreciate that. I want to give you some love. I'm going to give you some love that day.
I appreciate
you did a good
job. Well, there's so much I would love to cover with you. We've covered, like, all kinds of subjects and really trying to find out what's going on with black players in baseball and the front offices and everything else. You've coached, you've managed, you've been an all-star player. Managing, we're not seeing a lot of black managers anymore. Mm-hmm. And I look at you, and you're one game away from the World Series, and you never got that opportunity to get back managing. Do you think you'll get that opportunity? And what would your advice be to others that are coming along the way?
Well, you know, the game has changed so much. I back in the day, we had more old school general managers, guys who knew the game in a different way. Now that the game is changing analytically, I'm not sure if the timing of it just was kind of bad for me. I'm really disappointed I didn't get another shot because I really felt like after 06, 07, 08, bringing the team back to where we were, almost getting to the World Series, like you said, I thought I had a chance to continue to grow. Didn't work out. But I just feel like, you know, we need to get managers and coaches in the pipeline so when these opportunities come up, they can seriously be, you know, considered to delete these ball clubs because there are a lot of great talent out there. I mean, when I was managing in 08, I think, totally, there was like maybe, as far as minorities, there were like eight of us, I think, out there, and four African-Americans. Now, today, there's only one, Dave Robinson, in L.A., as the only black manager out there. So we need to get more guys in the pipeline. We need to have these general managers open up their minds and hire people they're not always familiar with, get to know some of these guys. There's a lot of great, great talent out there, coaches like DeMarlo Hale in the past, Lloyd McClendon, Bo Porter. It's a shame that he's not managing after doing a great job at Houston. I would love the opportunity to manage, Harold, but again, I'll stay ready, but I've been doing a lot of things off the field trying to let people know I'm still out there, but I love teaching, being involved at WBC, doing the Olympic trials just recently, whatever. I love to manage one more time, but again, my phone is always ready.
Hey, now, I know Dusty's sitting there with his toothpick saying, "Hold it now, Willie, I know it's 60 games, but I'm managing in Houston now. You left me out."
So, that's right. I'm sorry. That's right. I'm sorry, Dusty. And that's one of my mentors. You know, for a second, I forget about Dusty. But I'm rooting for him to do his magic, man. But sorry about that.
No, you talked about mentors and how important that is. And, you know, we had the group of the Players Alliance on earlier. And they were talking about mentorship and how they are mentoring the young guys that are coming up. So take me back to a young Willie Randolph when you were breaking into pro ball. And the numbers were so big with so many different black players. What were some of the things that they advised you on?
Yes. Well, I was fortunate, Harold. I came up in 1976 as a rookie, and I had great veterans around me like Roy White. Later on, Reggie Jackson came in 77. You know, Chris Chambliss was my first roommate. It was invaluable, the lessons that I learned from these guys who took me under their wing and taught me how to be a pro on and off the field. But more than anything, I think we had we could relate on things that were off the field, things that we're dealing with on the field. Nowadays, I think that players don't have that asset or don't have that leeway into getting that type of information. The Players Alliance, I think that's a great thing. I'm really proud of these young men, Curtis Granderson, the guys that are spearheading this whole thing. I just hope they continue to grow with each other and do things within the game, speak about social issues, and also do things off the field. And I think they're going to do a great job, and I would love to be a part of what they're doing. But we didn't have those kind of things when I was coming up. But guys like Chris Chambliss, Roy White, those kind of guys taught me the ropes, even guys like Thurman Munson. I mean, we had a great group of guys, but I was fortunate to be able to have guys around me that taught me how to play the game, taught me how to play the game right, and I could talk to them and deal with the issues that I had and have someone that was like me that I can relate to.
Really is awesome. Great stuff. And you know what? I think about, there's definitely a change coming. You know, when I start seeing what these guys are doing, and I'm so proud of them as well, and I know you yes. are, the change is definitely coming. You feel like there's a change?
Well, it's time. It really is time or whatever. I mean, the way the movement is going right now, nowadays, everybody's open to listening and being receptive to change and just you know, being able to communicate about things that we're not familiar with. You know, it's a good thing that a lot of the kids, black and white, are just opening up their minds and just having real dialogue, real conversations about things that we all deal with every day. But I think that we need to really make sure that we continue to move forward with this movement because, you know, in the past, we've gone through ups and downs and we kind of put it in the back burner. We have a great opportunity as a country, as a sport, especially in baseball, to open up everything and just you know, be able to just talk to each other. I really like the idea that Theo Epstein came out and really admitted the fact that, you know what, hey, man, I got to be different. You know, I got to, you know, look around the table and make sure I hire people that don't look just like me or that I'm always comfortable with. You know, if you get to know us, you get to feel what we're all about, then it opens up a whole new thing for everyone. So I'm just hoping and praying that we don't drop the ball here and move forward because there's so many great athletes out there who really want to be seen and have an opportunity to play this great game of baseball. And the athletes are there. We need to tap into that, man. And I hope that's and pray that plays out that way in the future.
Willie, thank you. You never drop the ball. One of my heroes. It's always great to talk to you, Willie. Thank you, man. Appreciate
love you,
Errol.
Thanks for having me on, buddy.
Always great to catch up to Willie Randolph. How do you not love that guy? And how do you not love baseball? I'm excited about what's going on in the game. I really believe there is a change coming. Nobody's enjoyed being home during the pandemic. But the one thing it has done, it's made us all sit there and have a conversation and recognize there are things that need to change. As we go through this show tonight and I look at what the players are doing and their vision for the future is exactly where we need to be in this game and in this country. So as we roll out, here's some things that stood out in the show tonight. Enjoy. We'll see you again. And thank you for watching MLB Tonight, a conversation.
You got to be perfect to be part of that
8%. We're looking for allies right now.
This is not only just for black players. I think that is super important, so we're not excluding anyone.
They need to go to college for that maturity level.
If they want the relationship to fail, by God, it's going to fail.
We want everybody to be equal across the board.
It's up to us now. We're those guys now sitting in this position to pass it on to the younger players.
You know, we have to do better. We have to do more.